Thundergrunt.
How long could we maintain?
I wondered!
How long until one of us starts raving and jabbering at this boy?
What will he think then?
This same lonely desert was the last known home of the Manson family.
Will he make that grim connection when my attorney starts screaming about bats and huge manta rays coming down in a car?
If so, well, we'll just have to cut off his head and bury him somewhere. Cause it goes without saying that we can't turn him loose.
He'd report us at once to some kind of outback Nazi law enforcement agency, and they'll run us down like dogs.
Jesus, did I say that?
Or just think it?
Was I talking? Did they hear me?
And now I'm returning and showing off a smile. I met all the girls and I love myself a few. And to my surprise, like everything else that I've been through, it opened up my eyes.
A small little ship in the center of Mars was a sack of souls with experiment scars. When a second of the monk said, I'll take two, and he put them in a rocket and he ate a lot of glue. And he shot them straight to Earth, and they turned into babies. They were named Bob and Matt, and they rarely got rabies. And the monk made a movie of their whole entire lives. They were penned and obscene, then zooms of the thigh. And one time Bob had sex with a ladle, and one time Matt lost a vet to a cradle, and another time Bob caught a dinosaur mom, and another time Matt bought a replica of Guam. And all this and more is on a DVD set, only $20.99 with the purchase of a gem. But if you call right now and say, where's my whisk, we'll include this bonus disc.
Hey! Welcome to Bonus Disc! The only show on the internet that does the thing that we do, which is break down movies scene by scene. I'm Bob Rose, and with me is Matt.
Hey! Hi.
God, my throat hurts.
I'm going to be really comparatively quiet.
I know.
What did you do? Just stop talking when you were like, the only show on the internet.
The only show on the bonus disc. The only show.
Move on.
Nothing else.
With us is Jesse Cumor. Hey, Jesse.
Hello.
How are you?
Hungover, but
right. Awesome. Well, that's perfect because today you got to watch Air Bud 12 with us.
It was
well. I just said that out loud. It's 12.
It's 12.
That's including all mythos prequels and such, which would be the ones that the last one we watched was a prequel. Yeah.
They have prequels.
No, it was a sidequel.
I mean, no, the last one was Spooky Buddies.
No, you're right. Spooky Buddies.
Wasn't
I'm sorry.
A classic.
Who the fuck knows?
I'm thinking
anymore.
Of Santa Paws and then Spooky Buddies, then Treasure Buddies. We watched Treasure Buddies.
Oh, boy.
Air Bud's kids do Indiana Jones.
Yeah.
Oh, Air Bud's kids. We're going to get into
that. Dude, there's this.
This movie blew things wide open. The fucking Air Bud mythos is completely out of control at this point.
I thought Spooky Buddies did. No, dude, this was huge in his lineage.
Unbelievable.
Air Bud is just unthinkably just important to humanity.
Yeah.
And the Earth.
You might not even, I don't know.
Sorry, I know, Jesse, you don't have context.
Yeah, I don't,
we're 12 movies in at this point.
You
this
guys.
Air Bud, he's all-powerful.
Something.
It's insane. He's very fucking important.
I've watched most of the original Air Bud movies that aren't Air Buddies just when I was a kid.
Like,
a little bit. I remember the first one.
Okay.
Because that one's dope.
Dude, if you think about what Air Bud means at the end of this movie compared to when you just watched the first movie.
It's
about
more than just Air Bud now.
And learn how to bite at a ball that was too large for its mouth by a fucking hobo clown. And now he's like
an Egyptian linchpin
in like humanity's fucking tapestry.
Not just humanity, like other species. Like,
oh my God.
It's important to all species on Earth.
This
like,
movie
all
is
powerful.
And he's not even in this movie. We're going to get to that.
It's more than Air Bud, though. It's a whole lineage.
Yeah, right. Oh no, it's God. Not just him. We found this shit out from his relatives. It's right, okay, anyway. We will get into it. Treasure buddies.
He was just a dog that bit at balls, though.
He saved a kid from getting, like, you know.
I understand, but it's just like, this is where we
remember there was that kid that was getting, like, beat by the coach. He did save the kid.
That was when he was
I'm just saying.
Because he's from God, Matt. Air Bud is from heaven.
He was just learning his powers at that time, though. Have you seen Smallville? Like, it takes a little while to get that shit down.
In this fictional universe, it seems almost that he has more influence on humanity than, like, Christ did.
Air Bud
think
is
about
God.
What this movie imposes.
No, I mean, everyone knows who they are.
I'm going to change my...
Anyway, all right, we got to start.
we got to start talking about... It's Treasure Buddies, which opens with Bobby, right?
Yeah,
you know, Bobby.
It opens with a monkey robbing someone and then running into a shack. And while he's hiding the loot, another monkey shows
up.
In
like a tomb crate.
Yeah.
Yeah, like sarcophagus.
Yeah.
Sorry, yeah.
Yeah.
And then they start talking and they have horrible Indian accents and it's awful.
They're
very clearly a white child trying to do an Indian accent.
We could probably spend hours talking about the racism and cultural appropriation of this movie. Just know it's really there.
It's so bad. A child trying to do an Indian accent.
It's not okay.
Like, can you hire an Indian child, maybe? So it doesn't sound crazy?
No, they had to hire all those kids with names like Ty and... Well, they had some weird names.
Brent, you know. Like super white people.
Chad.
So it's Bobby talking to his...
Nephew,
which was his name? Like, it was like Ooh Bobby.
Boo Boo or
Booby.
Booby.
Was it really?
Bobby
I don't remember.
It was not Bobby
dumb.
Booby.
Tits McGee.
I can't remember.
So he is like, you know, Uncle. Like, what?
Uncle Bobby. He's like, I've left organ grinding school to come learn to you how to be a treasure hunter, which is just a thief, because that's what he is.
Yeah.
And you're like, God damn it.
He's like, let me tell you this. Let me tell you. It's his voice. It's terrifying.
Also, the face CGI with the monkeys talking was like highly disturbing.
It is. It's very scary. I'll give them this. They kind of have the dogs down pat. They got the dogs down, but every other animal, it doesn't work right.
The dogs down pat.
I thought the camels were fine,
weird.
But like.
I don't know, the camel mom. We'll get to
that's a whole nother problem.
Yeah, it's a whole nother thing.
So no, he's like, tell me about the greatest treasure you've ever found. And he's like, it involves the buddies. And he's like, what? You knew the buddies? And I'm like, hold on.
They're in Egypt.
This is a monkey in Egypt. Why the fuck does he know who the
buddies
are? They didn't win the World Series. They didn't do shit.
Well, because
they did fuck nothing. They fight ghosts and shit in the fucking Midwest. Who gives a shit?
They are the grandsons of God. God damn it.
He's right. Jesse's right. Air Bud is the only reason, dude. At this point, because we don't see what we've talked about, and we don't know what Air Bud's doing, but at this point, he has got to be like a living god on this planet.
Yeah. Well, I said when we were watching, I was like, he probably Dr. Manhattan, and he's just like
some like Superman, like all powerful, flying around space.
He's remaking
and shit.
The Earth in space to his liking.
I tried to play by their rules.
Jesus Christ, man.
I'm super excited for the dark, gritty Air Bud reboot.
Dude,
that's
Zack
gonna
Snyder's
come out of
Air
this.
Bud. Please, I will watch that.
It's like an Earth Zero type thing where like Air Bud creates a parallel universe that he sculpts in his own, and he's like, it's perfect.
It is my image.
Ah, so good.
And there's all quadrants of the planet that are all for each sport, you know what I mean?
Oh, man.
We gotta keep going.
Okay. I want to watch that movie so bad.
We get another podcast.
The
we
world
can write Zack Snyder's Air Bud.
Fuck. Love it.
Make it happen, Hollywood.
Right. Seriously. So he tells him that he met the buddies and you know the buddies.
He's like, yeah, I saved their lives. He's like, no way.
And then they go back to 40 years.
Then he goes, okay, 40 years ago. 40 years ago, me, the monkey. Just a monkey. 40 years? Come on, man.
But hold on. In all fairness, though.
What is monkey life expectancy?
Hold on.
We didn't look that up. There's no fucking way.
He wasn't in this flashback, though. This is 40 years ago.
No, he was.
Was he in that flashback?
Yes. It shows him in the market in the flashback.
Oh, of the like young dad, the young grandfather. I thought. They
oh
were
just, yeah. There
no,
was
hold
the,
on. Because it's the oh, flashback.
No, no. Okay, yeah.
To the,
okay.
To the grandfather as a young
sorry.
Man.
Sorry,
and,
I got way
and Digger. Digger is a golden right. retriever. He's, and they're in like an Indiana Jones, like the Raiders of the Lost Ark type temple.
Yeah.
And he's uncovering the Cleocatra symbol. I just said that out loud.
Cleocatra
is a very real thing in this movie.
It's important.
And he pulls half of it like a, it's like a disc with hieroglyphics on it.
And
it's
a
not
cat
finished.
Eye.
Yeah.
It's
yeah.
not finished. And then, you know, they pull it out. And he's like, oh no, Digger. And everything starts shaking and rumbling. And it's basically the scene from Raiders.
Yeah. Minus
the rolling
ball.
Boulder. I was like, yeah. I would have literally just walked out of your house if there was a rolling boulder.
Ball.
Just like, all right, bye.
Imagine if it was a rolling ball and then Digger like hit it with his mouth.
What if Nazis showed up?
Dude.
I would have lost my
There's no
right.
way Air Bud's lineage didn't take out the Nazis.
Where's that one? You
it's
bold
coming.
To direct that
Yo,
one.
Man.
It's coming. That's going to be the next one.
That's it.
Air Bud 15, directed by U-Ball.
U-Ball.
Set in 1943.
Air comrades.
Bud's lit. Okay. So they make it out, but he drops the artifact, and then Digger picks it up and jumps heroically out of
the... Because Digger's just got an addiction for treasure that not even the archaeologist can match.
Well, I mean, we'll learn that he's destined to anyway.
Well, I mean, at this point, I just assumed Digger was just a golden retriever that was with an archaeologist. I didn't assume that he was important in any way.
Yeah.
So they make it out with the artifact, and then we cut...
to 40 years later in Fernfield, where he...
We see the sign. Yay.
Yes, we see
the
sign. The
sign
again.
Is in every movie.
Yeah, the so. Fernfield sign?
The Fernfield
yeah.
sign.
It cuts... What's it? The guy who played Santa Claus in...
Santa Paul's 2.
No, Santa Buddies. No, that was George
Wendt. That was George
Wendt. Santa Paul's.
Jesus. We sound like insane people.
Yeah, sorry. That was Santa Paul.
Sorry,
search.
Jesse.
That was the search for Santa Paul.
Just three grown men having a serious conversation about a kid's straight to video movie.
From 2012.
Oh, yeah,
it's not
God.
Even new.
So old.
So, yeah, we cut into the museum, and it's the guy from Office Space.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
That was really, that broke
so
his
So he
neck.
Plays
yeah.
Indiana. He's old Indiana Jones, which is hilarious.
Yeah, yeah. Didn't age well.
He
yeah.
did not age well.
It
yeah.
was the jump off was pretty bad. I thought maybe they would get like a better looking older guy.
Yeah. Also, the guy that was the original young dude seemed like he was a different ethnicity, didn't he?
Yeah.
A little
and
bit.
And then he turns into this old white man. It's like, what?
Okay. He also...
Oh, sure.
The original, like, younger version of him also looked, like, sleazy as shit, too.
Yeah.
He looked like Indiana Jones if he was, like, trying to sell you, like, a bag of cocaine.
They do not look like they could grow into each other. That man did not turn into this man, you know? It just didn't happen. Anyway, he now owns a museum in Fernfield.
Yeah,
which is located in the center of town.
It's in the town hall.
It's just in
like...
the town hall, right?
Yeah,
which
weird.
Is featured in all the movies.
Yeah,
anyway.
Buildings in every fucking
so,
movie.
In every movie.
It's a special museum. Yeah. Is the museum not in the town hall until this movie? Was that
well,
like? A first...
I mean, we've only ever seen the town hall from outside in every.
I
movie.
Assume it's just like an exhibit that's at the town hall.
Yeah,
okay.
We don't need an explanation on that.
Yeah.
It's just it's there.
But it's him showing the cats the thing he found. And he's like, well...
To a field trip. Once again, a field trip to all the kids that own the Buddies, and the Buddies are there.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
That happened in the last
Actually, they don't
movie.
Show all the kids' owners. They only
no,
show
they only
Pete.
Show Pete. Dirt, yeah.
Mudbutt.
Mudbutt.
Dirt Mudbutt.
Dirt Dog.
Dirt Dog. Yeah.
Mudbutt.
So he tells them the legend of Cleocatra. Right?
Yeah.
The Which legend is, of Cleocatra.
He's like, this is half the key to finding the lost tomb to Cleocatra and the necklace.
Yeah,
to
get
whatever.
The necklace that she.
Jesus. Well, we'll get to when they explain.
This isn't really.
They
don't explain
the
whole
thing here. Explain it here because it's infuriating,
dude. It's so confusing.
It doesn't make any
and
sense.
And then what it turns out to be is even worse.
Yeah, you're just like, huh.
What?
How did this
Why
happen?
Was that a treasure at all? It didn't seem like that was helpful to anybody.
It's just Pretty looking.
Yeah, so, the buddies are there, and they're like, what is this cat shit? Fuck
and,
that.
And we see a guy walk in the background.
With a cat.
With a cat in his arm.
And then he has a little cat cane.
It's the guy from, the evil guy from Lost Boys. The dad from Richie Rich. And
grandfather from Gilmore Girls.
Yeah,
I can't remember his name.
I know he passed away. This, I didn't look it up, but I'm pretty sure this has to be like one of the last things he ever did.
Okay.
It has
this is last
he died like 3 years ago.
Okay, so it was his last
film. It has to be like one of his last on-screen appearances. So he's walking around in the background, right? Then the class disperses and the buddies, what the fuck did they
They walk up to all these like artifacts and they're talking about shit.
They're like,
B-Dog's being a fucking terrible
once again, man, when the guests see B-Dog for the first time, I love it. Everyone's just like, Jesus.
It's terrible,
God.
Man.
He's the worst.
He's literally the worst. Like,
would you say it was grating?
Yeah, he's everything. Literally every word that leaves his mouth is just grating.
It's pretty bad.
And especially when he says bling, but we'll get to that later.
Oh, man. This movie is, like, concentrated on the bling.
I know. It was bling heavy.
They're, like, looking at this one, like, scene and of statues.
Yeah, and then they think one of them's
alive.
Well, they're like, I think that cat's eyes moved. And they're like, dude, just calm down. Let's get tripping. Out of here. And then B-Dog goes, I'm all up in your grill, cat.
Son.
What's up? What are you going to do about it? And God, you were just like, why?
I groaned when it said groan on the screen.
Yeah.
Because B-Dog's just terrible.
He's
hard on the ears.
But it turns out that cat was
real, and it hisses at him.
It was a hairless, like, James Bond cat.
Yeah. Mr. Bigglesworth.
Mr. Bigglesworth, yeah. And
what do we call on the guy? What's his name? The
Englishman,
the grave robber guy. Oh yeah, he's Englishman.
He's English.
He's supposed to be English. His accent is so fucking like barely. It's so faint.
He just talks really pretentiously.
Yeah, yep. Kind of.
How are you today? You know, he doesn't really talk English.
Yeah.
But the cat was for some reason posing as
he
a
definitely
statue.
Never called anybody a cunt or anything.
No, he didn't.
Yeah, the cat.
He wasn't Cockney.
The cat was posing as a statue for
what reason?
No,
there
was like literally no reason.
There was no reason.
I think she was. I feel like she had. Remember, she had her own motives.
She's owned by the evil, the antagonist of the movie, but she also has her own plans separate from him.
And I think she was maybe trying to steal, like, the key to the tomb.
But it's not there.
Yeah.
It's not there.
It wasn't there? Okay.
Either way.
No, it was in the display case.
Yeah, it was in the display case. So maybe she was just trying to...
While that happens, the field trip leaves, but Pete stays.
And the grandfather takes the key out of
him. And he tells him more about it.
I think we're just starting
to
realize that this particular aspect of this film makes no sense.
It doesn't really make sense.
Why she was a statue. No, it was just a setup so that we could listen to B-Dog.
They give the dogs... Just stuff
too much
to say.
Yeah.
Don't need to speak, they're just talking. It's awful.
Well, we'll find out later that the dogs don't need to be in the movie at all.
Oh, no. Nope. They are completely superfluous to this movie.
I guess to save the camel, but like...
Fuck the camel. Who's the kid's camel? It's like, whatever. He basically tells his grandson, who Pete...
He tells him the real legend or whatever, right? Because he pulls it out of the case, and he explains what...
Is that when it flashes back? Because
doesn't they talk about Budasi at this point?
Yeah, that's when they first bring up Budasi,
which is
he's
the first Air Bud.
He's the first Air Bud
from ancient Budasi.
But some people say his name like Budasi in the movie, and it made me laugh like every
single
time.
But it was Budasi. It was obviously supposed to be a Bud reference.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And
he was the dog that, like, Jesus Christ.
He stopped.
He stopped Cleopatra from
who was
using.
The cat of Cleopatra.
Yeah. Who, from stealing the necklace and making.
That gave the power. He took the power away from the cat and made dogs
man's best friend.
Instead, because cats wanted to take it.
And
the original Cleopatra wanted to use it. Hold on, Matt. Cleopatra wanted to use the power of the necklace to make cats the dominant race on Earth, whereas Budasi used it to make dogs man's best friend and to stop cats from taking over the world.
And I think there was a cat banishment for a little while.
Yes, said they banished cats.
What? Like,
just all right, cats.
So, yeah, it doesn't.
What doesn't make any fucking sense is that So this Cleopatra has a necklace
and a cat. Yeah.
And a cat. And the cat is like, what? Okay, what the fuck was Cleopatra using the power of the necklace for beforehand?
For it, yeah. Dude.
Then a cat was like, I'm going to wear that shit.
To make
this is a universe.
I'm going to make human slaves. And then a dog goes, nah, son. And then Cleopatra's like, I love dogs. Cat's gone. Who then builds a goddamn giant, like, hidden temple dedicated to the corpse of the cat who tried to kill humanity and leave the necklace that gives you powers in it?
But what powers?
What
the fuck?
What kind of decision was that?
What powers do the necklace really give you? That's the other thing.
To affect what animal has second dominance over Earth?
That's literally.
That's what the necklace
is. It's such a weird goal.
What the fuck?
It's a very specific magical artifact.
Also, I'd like to remind you, like I said, we were watching it. That is the plot to Cats and Dogs. It actually goes to ancient Egypt, and it talks about how cats were like.
What year did that come out?
Oh, 2001.
Yeah, I was a kid when that came out.
It talks about how dogs have always been man's best friend, and they stopped cats from taking over the world. That's like the backstory of Cats and Dogs.
Yeah.
And then Treasure Buddy stole it.
So
okay.
Just insert Air Bud into that. Let's just use the Air Bud injector.
So at that point, I think we could just assume that calling him Budasi was just a clever... It was supposed to be clever, but it's not. But I didn't think it was actually going to link. You know what I mean? So that's when we cut back. And the grandfather is in his office with Pete and... the buddy and Mudbud.
They're not in an office. They're just standing in the area.
Well, they go into the office because that's when he puts on. There, he asks his grandfather, like, "Is that you? Is that Digger?" And he says, "Like, yeah." And he shows him, "Here's Digger's original like handkerchief."
And he puts it on Mudbud, and he's like, "Here's this awesome."
He looks
compass.
Just like his grandfather.
So
that's when my brain broke. Whoa, Digger is freaking Air Bud's granddad.
No, he would be Air Bud's dad because
Air Bud's dad, right.
From 40 years ago, but like...
40 years ago!
These dogs are immortal beings, man.
Well, yeah, when the fuck did he have Air Bud? How
that means
old
Air Bud
is
would
Air
have
Bud?
To be about 25 years old, and then his dad lived to be like really old before giving birth, you know, before having him. It just they have to have lived to the peak of golden retriever lifespan.
He had one last bang.
Yeah, right. Right, right.
What if when the air... Oh, my God. What if... I don't know. This may be
put
too
it together.
Big. What
connect
if...
Connect the dots.
I'm just saying, what if they, like... What if the first... all the Air Bud movies that had Air Bud in them...
Right, right, right.
Exist as Air Bud movies in the universe of Air Buddies, and Air Bud is just a movie star.
Dude, that's
what?
A lot.
I know what.
Sorry,
yes,
I don't
your
know.
Face hit. What?
Jesus. That's Whoa. Too much.
It's a lot, man.
It's like being on a Lost forum.
It is kind of like how in the Muppets movies, there's some Muppet movies that are continuity, and some Muppet movies
that
are the Muppets starring in movies.
Yeah, like I feel like that's Treasure
Treasure Island and Christmas Carol, and actually Muppets from Space all take place out of continuity.
Really? Muppets from Space is out of continuity?
Yes, because there is a Muppets from Space poster in the new Muppet movie that was made.
Okay.
Which shows that it was a movie in continuity. They were just...
That's pretty crazy.
Yeah. That could be... I don't think so. But that's insane. That's nuts. Because in the first movie, Bud comes from nowhere. He comes from like... He's just...
Yeah,
he's on
a
lake.
Hobo clown.
He's just from nowhere.
And left on the side of the road. He's nothing.
But somehow, Pete's grandfather...
That's why I'm thinking, like, those weren't real. Like, Air Bud's actually, like, this, like, famous-ass, like, movie star, because they just made these movies.
The movies up.
Those were films. That's not his real-life story.
Think about it.
Because otherwise,
grandfather owned Bud's dad, and then somehow
Bud got...
I guess Bud's dad would be in Fernfield, though.
He was in Fernfield, but that guy wasn't in Fernfield. He... came to Fernfield.
Well, I thought he was just on an adventure, but
they were moving to Fernfield. They were moving.
Jesse, it's
sorry.
Important that we understand. We put a lot of time into understanding these things.
They moved to Fernfield in the first movie, so they and found him on the road. They, you remember, they almost
right,
hit him on the road.
But Pete's one of the buddies.
Kids. And when they took him, they had to go to another city, which is why we thought it was insane that he was watching Air Bud on TV in a different city because it was a middle school basketball game, which should not have been broadcast anywhere.
That's the villain in the first
one. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So it was in a different city.
Oh, my.
Dude, that's what I'm saying.
That's what I'm saying. Air Bud is a movie star. The first five films are canon. Like,
or he's still, I say he's still from God.
He's from heaven. He's a fucking god, man. Yeah.
He's a cherub. He's like an angel from heaven.
He's also a movie. He's like Superman, dude.
Oh, man, he's just Airbud
is Superman.
Part of this lineage of like destined for greatness dog thing, and it just happens. Airbud exists during like when pop culture exists.
Their lineage,
so
of
like
Egyptian
he just
super
becomes,
dog.
Like, you know what I mean?
Well,
he
in one movie,
an athlete,
one movie does
star.
Confirm he has super genes. So. As four confirms that he is
you know,
super sports
but
gene.
As far as I'm concerned, that's not real. That's a movie within the Air Buddies.
Dude,
universe.
I don't know about this theory.
It's like I look at it more of kind of like, you know, like the Apocalypse mutant storyline, you know, like Budassi being like Apocalypse the first mutant, and they're all just like mutant retriever dogs from
passed
Egypt.
Down.
Was okay, never mind.
Well, either way, that one line that is a throwaway line, it throws the
minds.
Entire universe of Air Bud into chaos.
It's really crazy.
You just like your grandfather. What?
Yeah.
Oh, my bitch. Just aneurysm.
They further the universe.
Right. And that is when evil Englishman walks in. I'm going to call him Mr. Rich, because
okay.
I don't know his name, and he's Richie Rich's dad to me, so.
Let's call him Gilmore Dude.
Gilmore Dude. Richie
I'm going to call him Head Vampire.
Head Vampire.
All right.
Well, this is his other villain role.
Yeah.
There's Lost Boys in this. And Treasure Buddies. So he
head,
walks
yeah.
in. He what?
Head Vampire walks
head
in.
Head Vampire walks in and he says, and he pitches him some idea, like, what if you did
he's
have
like,
the other half?
Yeah,
know?
And he's like, well, I mean, I'm old and I don't know. Yeah, and then he goes, well, what if it's right in front of your face, motherfucker? And he, like, pulls it out. And he's like, whoa,
he puts
boners.
He puts it together with the old piece. Where did you find this? How? And he's like, not without a lot of trying.
He, like, insinuated that he was working with the Egyptian government and that they were keeping it on the...
Down
like,
the D, yeah,
like the DL until the they found
QT, didn't he?
I can't remember what
he
said.
Some weird thing,
but until they find the location of the tomb,
yeah,
right.
And he's like, "Oh my god!" And then two men over the age of 70 say, "Let's go to Egypt with a 10-year-old boy."
And so they go to his parents' house,
and they're like, "Sure." His father is played by Cliff. Or
Lachlan Monroe. Cliff from Dead Man on Campus.
Okay.
Remember that.
I know him from something as well, the guy who played the dad. I just can't remember what exactly.
Ready to Rumble?
I feel like... Yeah. Oh, no. Was he in Ready to Rumble?
Yeah, he was one of the stars of Ready to Rumble.
Oh, boy.
He's the guy who's not David Arquette.
Oh, no, that's yeah. him? Jesus.
He's Sal not Bandini. David Arquette. Yeah.
Right. And so they
and they're like, sure, take our 10-year-old boy to Egypt to hunt for magic artifacts, digging holes in places that might have booby traps full of killer scorpions, bandits,
deserts,
the sun.
I wouldn't even let somebody take my child to Egypt just on a vacation.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like with a man that we've never met.
An
just a random
His
British man.
His grandfather was like, this guy just showed up at my office. And he wants me to go to Egypt with him to go on an adventure. Can I take my grandson?
He likes
sure.
archaeology.
What?
He just likes being dirty.
Whatever.
Anyway.
So Mudbud is really worried about Pete, and he also wants to go.
So he
does the Avengers Assemble yell out of his front door.
Yeah.
And then they teleport to the airport.
Yeah.
Airport,
they beat the family in the car. Yeah. This is the best part. They beat the family in the car who left before they all have to assemble first.
Yeah, he had to go get them. Like Unbelievable.
They show tell them
once
we're
again,
going to the
related to Bud.
Yeah, that's why I said they're teleporting.
You can't question anything if you have Bud's genes in you.
They're mutants, man.
Well, technically speaking, Butterball is a fucking mutant. Yeah. He has powers. Which we are going to get to soon.
He killed
a powerful demon
with a fart.
It doesn't
make any sense.
Okay.
So they're
getting on the plane, and then the air buddies are just standing on the tarmac. No one notices that.
Yeah,
as usual, the buddies can literally just stand anywhere.
I'm telling
and
you,
humans don't see.
Humans
them.
Can't
they got, like,
see
cloaking.
Below their feet or their knees. They can't see below their knees in this.
And this
is
where it just blurs past. It's just blurry past your knees. You can't see anything.
It's just a level of fog.
Yeah.
The film
filters
so
out. Pigs can't look up, you know.
They all jump into a crate that's marked explosives.
Yeah.
And there's a shot of them all just sitting in
dynamite.
Like a cartoon dynamite stack.
It like bars a C4.
It's awesome.
I was taken aback. Like, whoa.
Like in the snow or Santa buddies or snow buddies, I was like, dude, they get air dropped in a crate full of
ice cream.
And we were like, dude, that's brutal. Now they're getting like shipped to like across
Egypt
the ocean.
A box of explosive
like, dynamite.
More, dude.
Oh man. So now they're in the plane. I mean, it shows like the whole like Indiana Jones like map thing.
And
happening.
Literally the song that's just like the Indiana Jones theme was like
awesome.
It was just not quite there. It was great.
when they get there, I mean right before they get there, Butterball,
he's like oh,
this
so
cheese
hungry.
Looks really weird.
Like, I'm so hungry. I think this stuff's cheese.
It's the C4.
And they're like, I don't know, that cheese smells weird. He's like, yeah, it's a stinky cheese, man. He starts eating it.
He eats like a whole bar of C4. I'm pretty sure they insinuated that he ate a whole bar of C4.
And then
a whole C4.
I mean, I guess
that's insane to like. Write that on a piece of. Here's a kids' movie.
This dog
where a puppy eats a bar of C4. That's insane!
And like, it plays it off.
I mean, I never would have seen it coming in a fucking buddy's movie.
Plays
Robert
it off
Vince
too.
Is a goddamn maniac. He's insane!
It's a creative fucking genius.
God.
Oh.
So they land in. They even say where it is exactly. It's just Egypt.
Yeah, they just landed in Egypt.
It's called. They do say the name. It's like Budahari or something.
Is it real? It wasn't.
I don't know if it's
it
a real place.
It was probably made up.
When we first see the shot of them, well, I guess they land in the planes first. What does anything?
They get off
there,
the plane
interest?
And then it introduces the two idiots.
That's right. Like Sarik and
Taki or something.
Tafik.
I think it was Tariq.
They're two idiots. One of them is eating like was it hummus?
It was falafel.
No, it was a falafel. He was
a falafel.
Eating, like way too much sauce on it.
Insane amount of sauce.
It was a lot of falafel sauce.
He's eating it, and they're like, hey, can you help me with this crate? And he puts the falafel down
on the crate.
It
drips on Butterbean. Butterbean's like, it's
Butterbean.
Butterbean. Butterbean
the boxer.
That'd be awesome. Butterbean and
Butterbean.
Four dogs.
Oh, dude. I wish there was a Butterbean cameo.
It's just four dogs and Butterbean.
In a box of explosives.
In a box of explosives.
But in the
Butterbean
movie,
eats
Butterbean. B-U-D-D.
Butterbean.
Butterbean's in a Butterbean.
What's this dog's name? Because I'm just going to keep calling him
Butterbean.
If no one tells me what it is, I'll just keep calling him
Butterbean.
It drips on Butterball. He calls the sauce falafel sauce, which I'm pretty sure isn't the actual term.
Do we know that?
No, I don't know. It's some kind of cucumber sauce.
No, that's
the Greek sauce on a gyro.
It's a similar. It's a similar sauce.
Yeah,
like
it's like
cucumbery.
Yogurt and cucumber. Yeah,
but
it's really good. But
it's different than the.
Well, he
Ziki.
Starts eating.
But
that.
The dog, he eats it and knows they're in. He's like, oh, we must be in Egypt.
Yeah,
and you're like, hold on, wait,
the cuisine
what?
So well that. He knows where they are based on the sauce dripping into a crate of dynamite, which they are in.
Or he's just a racist
ass
dog.
The mental gymnastics to write that that
he
down.
Could just,
you know what I mean? How does he know where they are? Yeah. Well, they're in this crate of dynamite, and a man puts sauce
he could just be,
all over.
He could just be.
Someone just dumped sauce all over this crate of dynamite. We must be in Egypt. Like, what the fuck is going on? Yeah.
I also feel like Butterball is mildly racist for just assuming because it's falafel
sauce
that we're
in
Egypt.
Yeah.
You can't get falafels anywhere but Egypt.
Those guys load the crate onto a truck, right? Because they have to go to that.
Yeah.
The town that they go to is like this, with just all walled in
but before,
square
yeah.
town.
Actually, well, but I guess before they go on the truck, though, they because they get the Pete and the grandfather get to the little town first.
Yeah. They're always ahead of the buddy.
You get that shit shot where it makes it look like a Renaissance fair or something. It looks so bad.
It looked like said, bad high school like theater set. Like
it, to me, I think they filmed this at a Disney theme park that had, like maybe Epcot or something.
Yeah,
they just had the set and they just did it like a couple.
Oh,
days.
Epcot looks better than that shit though.
I don't know, man. It looks like a theme park.
Yeah,
it just looks like that level. They probably set dressed it, but
yeah.
It looks like theme park level, like Egypt. You know what I mean? Like the mummy, the ride of the Brendan Fraser mummy. This is probably like the waiting area. That, you know? Yeah. That's what it looked like.
It kind of looks like that.
The mummy flume.
Looks like
the mummy flume.
That exists.
Are you
thing.
Serious?
They made rides out of that movie.
Yeah, there's a mummy flume ride.
Yeah,
that exists.
So that's probably like the waiting.
They're
area.
In a desert. There's a water. Why is it a flume? Why wouldn't it be any other kind of ride? Why would you pick a flume ride for a desert themed movie about stuff covered in sand?
I don't know.
Because fuck it, we're Universal Studios. We don't give a shit.
Jesus
they want,
Christ.
Man. So the grandfather and Pete are there, and that's when they run in. Well, that's like, there's so much stuff in this market. This market sucks.
Yeah, I don't. Oh, man.
Dude.
It's just people walking around the market interacting with
these are dried peas.
They're like, good for snacking.
I'm 89 years old. God, I hate this.
And the buddies all. Wait, the buddies showed up at this point. I can't remember.
Well, this is when the first meet cute happens between the child and
the
other.
Meet cute.
That
whole
storyline could be in the trash. It doesn't matter at all.
It's
so
nothing.
It's awesome. It's so useless.
It was to give 12-year-old children boners.
Yeah! She's hot. Like some 10-year-old boy. Like, oh,
I'm gonna imagine those two banging tonight, you know? Like
So he meets some girl. I forget her name. Tala or something?
Farah.
And then
her dad looks kinda creepy and weird the first time you meet him.
Here,
the
right?
monkey steals the
The watch.
He
of
steals
head
the
vampire.
No. The no. He steals the compass
from
off
the kid, Pete. And he goes to steal the.
And then he tries to steal the head vampire's watch.
But then the cat's like, "What are you doing, thief?"
Wait, Bob.
You
have to
petty
call.
Primate.
You have to call Mr. Rich. I'm calling him head vampire.
Oh, Mr. Dude, we're so it's so confusing.
No, let's give it a shot. I know it'll be confusing.
She calls
of course I call Mr. Rich. His face is on Mount Richmore, man.
Yeah. Fuck, man.
Yeah, I'm famous. Yeah. So that's because the cat
he tries
hates
to steal the
monkey
cat's like get the
thief.
Fuck out of here.
He's a petty primate. Yeah,
she hates primates.
Yeah, she calls him a petty primate every single time she sees his character.
That's and he does end up stealing the watch, right?
He goes away, and then the
buddies all start begging for free shit.
Yeah, that's when I feel like the buddies show up, and they just like.
Oh wait, hold on, wait. They get out of the crate. By Butterball, something. Okay, so they've been sitting in this box for hours, like possibly a day. I mean, I don't know how long it takes
from Egypt. That's like a 14-hour flight.
Yeah, it's got
to
be.
They've been in this
box for a long ass time.
And they're puppies. So you know,
halfway through that ride, he ate a bunch of explosive right?
Z4.
I feel like it didn't sink in when we were watching it, and now I'm realizing what happened.
And then as they're opening the crate in Egypt, she goes, "Hey, I think that's explosives you ate." It's been like 7 hours since he ate.
He's been digesting C4.
What tipped her off after 14 hours in a box that it was explosives then?
And what did it matter? Anyway, every time he farts, like, demons die. People think things are on fire.
Yeah.
Like, this stuff is noxious. It's toxic.
Like Jesse said, he's a mutant, and his stomach is his power.
Yeah, this is his power.
He could digest anything.
He ate C4, and then he farts. They make a Dutch oven joke.
Yeah, and you were like, a fucking Dutch oven joke.
Yeah. And it was like, the girl. She's like, you better not Dutch oven us. I was like, you know what Dutch ovening is?
Your dog.
Yeah.
Your puppy. You don't sleep in sheets.
You're all less than a year old. You're not even human. But you know where... You know where a country is based on the sauce, and you know what a Dutch oven it is.
So there's a Dutch
the
oven.
The sauce thing is amazing.
Yeah. We're in Egypt, I can tell by the falafel
by
sauce.
The sauce dripping all over me.
So good. They're also so like so culturally ignorant that the girl gets like a shawl put on or whatever.
Yeah, yeah. For
and
free.
She calls it a bow. Oh. At one point, she's like, oh, "You're just jealous of my pretty bow."
OMG, this bow's to die for. That's literally what she said.
Well, she's the female dog, so she obviously likes
OMG.
Fashion and
accessories. Insane OMG.
Right.
There's also another line about her being feisty. Like she's more feisty than all the other ones put together. You know, like she doesn't do anything.
She doesn't. She doesn't do anything.
So they're opening this crate.
He farts orange
and
gas.
Farts like orange smoke bomb gas.
Which I thought, is that a reference to like sarin gas?
That
like our Agent Orange? Or like Agent Orange? You know what I mean?
Just I wasn't even thinking about that at all.
But they made a reference to Agent Orange.
I don't think they made a reference to Agent Orange. I feel like that is completely coincidental.
Jesus.
He ate C4, man. What are you doing? The guy's like opening the case, like, oh, it's gonna explode with all the gas. It's like,
and that's when they just escape.
Yeah, they escape from that, and then the buddies are in the market.
Yeah, sorry. The buddy
all
market.
All the stuff
thing.
That kind of happens with them just meeting people in the market is dumb.
Yeah, they're just begging for free shit.
But that's when they get Butterball tries to get free kebab, and Bobby steals
that's when
it.
Bobby steals it. He's like, "Hey, I gotta get my kebab," and he runs after him.
And then they confront him in an alleyway, and he's like. They're like, you stole my kebab. And he's like, well, here's my hat.
Yeah.
He's like, I don't want your hat. And he's like, yeah, but you look good. And he's like, nah, yeah, you're right. All right, fine.
And then.
You're like, what the fuck? Why
do we need to see that?
Yeah, then they notice he's wearing the compass.
Yeah, and he's like, you stole the compass. So they trade. Bling. They trade
B-Dog's bling. He takes B-Dog's bling for the compass.
And he's like, you can't have my bling, dog. You must be hallucinatrippin', which he also said in the last movie, which is dumb.
Hallucinatrippin'.
Hallucinatrippin'.
That's
when you eat enough C4.
You fart bombs.
Also, there is a cutaway to a guy that is auctioning off camels, which is sadly important here.
You're
right.
Yeah, sadly, it's important is that there's a guy that's auctioning off camels, and one of the camels does not sell.
It's a baby camel.
Then Bobby.
Well, also, the cat has already seen that the buddies are there.
She's not happy about it. Right. Then Bobby is like, "Hey, I know a safe place where you can. It's dangerous in the market at night, so I know a safe place where you can sleep." Turns out it's the camel's stable.
Yep.
Where they're staying. And then, you know, the guy brings the camel in. I hate the storyline.
Dude, I love this part,
like,
though,
oh,
because
yeah.
He's like, look, if you don't sell tomorrow, I'm gonna kill you.
He said, I'm gonna slit your throat.
He literally just, like, he just kind of does the, like throat slit, like, action with a little, like, sound effect. He's like, if you don't sell tomorrow, you know?
It's like, if you knew that all the animals in this universe could talk, Would you
murder them?
Would you do that
to them?
They
know they can. They don't know.
No, but like, why would you do that to an animal? Like, the way he did it, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, why would you say it to it if you didn't understand it could understand you?
I mean, I talk to the dog sometimes.
Yeah,
know
people
what I mean?
Just
like but it's like affectionate.
No, but if
you,
if you were planning
like
to
murder it.
Yeah,
yeah,
saying, if you were to murder, you'd be like, man, if I don't sell this thing, I'm gonna fucking kill it.
You wouldn't talk directly to it.
It's just
he's malicious.
Like, it's costing me money.
He fucking hates that camel.
Yeah, but
bro.
He was just like,
we
hey,
need some backstory on that guy that we never
get. Make a whole movie about him.
So they talk to the camel, and the camel says, I want to go back to my family.
I was stolen.
I need to get back to my family.
If I wait too long, they'll be too far away.
Also, we were introduced to the nomad tribe, right? before this?
Yeah, that was the girl. That was
the little girl. Yeah,
the little girl the kids trying to find.
Okay, so she. But the camel's like, I just, if you guys help
dude,
me.
Dude, the camel's voice, Bob. I'm talking about the camel's voice.
Yeah.
Trying to describe
all
it.
It's like a three-year-old.
All the Egyptians.
But the camel's fucking huge.
Yeah,
here's my problem
hey,
with it.
I take it from my family.
All of the other Egyptian animals have Egyptian accents, but the fucking camels are just white people. And they have names like Nana and stuff too. Yes. And they're just like, "Hello, would you like to come to my tribe?"
Welcome to Bangladesh.
This is when they say, "Like, look, if you want to get out of here, I have a plan." And they're like, "Okay, we'll do it tomorrow morning when the guy comes." And then we cut to it's nighttime.
No, he goes, "You guys go to sleep. I'm going to go find out what's going on." And he
steals
and
some shit.
And Bobby goes spies on...
On the grandfather,
which this is... I love this. I love their adventure.
is
the most
so boring
goddamn thing.
Shit.
They're sitting in a hotel room and they're like, "Well, it's a riddle. It's this thing. Moon, keyhole." Like, he keeps saying this thing over and over again. And
there's
then the little boy goes...
a moon and a keyhole.
And he goes, "Well, I mean, it's night right now and that thing looks like a needle. It's got
and
a little
got a
moon,
moon
on it."
And
he's like...
an obelisk in the center of town.
And he's like, "Oh, boner, old like
old boner.
Adventure boner." And then they run down there
old
and like
adventure boner.
Put the thing in the disc in the thing, and then it turns, and then
Goonies keys, and then
like a laser beam shoots.
Dude, it's so bright,
86 miles away. It fires
and
a beam of light.
People that are standing around them don't look up.
They don't give a fuck.
No,
they're
like, whatever.
No, it's another magical beam.
Great.
They're just not. It happens all the time. Beams and shit all over the place.
My grandmother got eaten by a bunch of scarabs 3 years ago. I'm just gonna fucking. I'm not getting
you know
involved.
What? Not following any sun or moonbeam.
Nope.
Things anymore. Yeah.
They've learned their lesson.
I said we should have knocked that thing over at the last town hall meeting. I said it.
So that the best part is they make this huge discovery of like, okay, so this is pointing in the direction of Cleocatra's tomb.
To an oasis.
Well, let's go to sleep.
It was specifically pointing to an oasis that they had to go to. And yeah, then they were just like,
"It was activated by moonlight."
This is activated by a key this man spent his entire life protecting. And he's like 80 years old and he finally...
That's why he's got to go to bed.
He's finally...
He's
like, "We did it! Now let's take a nap."
All right, now it's nap time, boy.
Yeah. So they go to bed and then Bobby goes back.
It's unreal.
They wake up the next morning and then, you know, they hear that guy, the evil camel salesman, whistling. And they're like, "Okay, now I got a plan."
Man, we
should have
looked at the credits. I wish his credit was evil camel
salesman.
Evil camel salesman.
But the thing is, it's like she says with a female.
She's
buddy,
like, "I don't know what to do." And then one of the dogs is like, "I've got an idea."
Yeah.
And then he opens the door. She just spits in his face.
The
and
camel spits. Oh!
It's like the thing weighs four times as much as him. Every time he opened the door, it could have trampled him.
I know. And then they don't even, like another example of them not killing someone they should have killed. They just leave the guy with a spit on his face.
That camel should have stomped that motherfucker's
head. There's so
in.
Many moments in this movie where someone should have straight up killed
stabbed.
Somebody.
And I love that they run away from that guy, and then the wide shot shows them just... like strolling out of town so slow.
Yeah, it's like,
here's a camel
and
a bunch of
literally right during that shot,
like
Bobby goes, "They
heroes.
Escaped," and it's just like them, like.
Oh wait, before that though, Bobby pulls a hose out of the engine of one of
the trucks.
The trucks.
Sorry, right. To slow them down.
Yeah, to slow them
yeah.
down.
It's so boring.
They start driving. The car breaks down. They're like, car.
Does anyone know?
First they encounter.
Oh, wait.
Nomads.
This actually, I like this when they're like, "Do you know anything about cars?" And then the grandfather's
well, no,
like, "Well,
this, they
fuck yeah, I do." And he walks in there and he goes,
like,
"The
hose
is on." Like.
Right before that, though,
it was like a sitcom. I wish it just like he looked at the camera, you know, just like, "It's just the hose."
Right before that was the whole Blazing Saddles. It was the whole Blazing Saddles thing where they like. They're driving, and then in the way is a bunch of nomads. And
yeah.
I was like, "You're in the desert, though. There's no road."
Yeah.
No one's really in your way. But instead, they're like, there's a camel sitting there, and and he's like, "Don't worry, son. These are just the Boheme or whatever."
I forget. They're real. It was a real actual
the boner,
tribe.
The boner tribe.
The boner tribe.
They're not the boner tribe.
Boner tribe.
I can't remember the name.
It's like the it's something.
Bougie. I can't remember.
It was a name that sounded
bougie.
Real. Bougie. The Boner Tribe.
The Boner
there.
Tribe?
And a mysterious dad figure.
A Boondie or something.
A Boondie. A mysterious dad figure of the girl, Fala.
Yeah.
That the boy is in love with was like her father. And he's like, just be careful going, you know, can be a dangerous place with
the love interest.
Yeah, the love interest. But he's like, there's thieves and robbers in this. Yeah, sorry he's for like, my racist voice. That guy sounded terrible. And so he like moves.
He like
camel,
warns them.
He
and
warns
then
them, and then
they drive on, and then their that's
then the car breaks
the
down.
Car breaks down. Then he puts the two.
Then
back
the dogs
in.
Are like walking in the fucking desert,
straight in the desert, right? And we're like, shouldn't they be like
drinking water,
hungry and thirsty? They haven't eaten anything.
So that's when the camel explains what a camel
is
to a dog who just told it to spit in someone's face. Which unless you did, you just think, like that. I mean, that's the camel's thing, is spitting. Did she just not? Did she not know that already?
No, and then she tells them that
they knew about the sauce, but not a camel.
She tells them that they can. Here's another gem from that scene.
Fuck.
She tells them that
this
camels puke up their own food and then re-chew it and eat it again.
And
then, Butterbean does it.
Butterbean. But
yeah, he does
what
it.
What was
though.
The last thing he ate? C4.
Yes.
C4 was the last thing he ate.
Sauce. He ate some sauce.
He licked a little
some C4.
The last solid thing that he ate that he could
combo.
Throw up and chew on again
was
C4.
Right.
And some, yeah.
What if his mouth blew up right then? That would have been good.
I mean, I'm pretty sure C4 can explode from impact.
No, it's
like
a logical
charge. He's a god, so
that's right, he's
a god. From the lineage.
Either way, he basically regurgitates C4 into his mouth and then re-swallows it.
With some falafel
it,
sauce
and,
then re-swallows
it. That was tasty.
It.
Yesterday's leftovers.
Ugh.
He is not... His digestive system is superpowered. That's the explanation for all of this.
It doesn't make any sense. But what if he, like, threw up his prolapsed stomach and just kind of chewed it?
And, like, it's, like, the only good effects in the film. It's, like, really realistic.
Dude, it's, like, the face or something. It's, like, so... Yeah.
That would have been
it's,
awesome.
Like, some fucking, like, Tom Savini did it.
So... Yeah, that whole issue of them being starving is addressed. And then... Not long after this, he has the mirage, right? Not that we need to even address
no,
that
that's
happening.
Later because then they see the actual
right.
trees.
So we cut back to the humans and...
They've fixed the cars, they've driven on, they've gotten to the oasis.
Yeah, they get to the oasis.
God, they set up a
so
camp.
Boring,
it's
man.
Like
really
the most boring adventure that ever
so
happened.
It's 2 80-year-old men going on an adventure
with
like,
a
10-year-old boy being followed by
Not
a bunch
fun.
Of puppies.
They get to the oasis and they see
they
a
set
well.
Up. Yeah.
And they're like,
and
well,
he's like, this is where the river
the
is.
The best part is the grandfather is like, well, it could be anywhere in this oasis, the doorway to the...
And, then, and while he's saying it, he trips.
And falls over it.
I just want to point out, like, what you're saying, like, he's starting to give his speech. He's also... They are on the fucking edge of this oasis. Like, it's big.
Oh,
they're
yeah.
on the fucking edge of it. Like, there is bare sand and
like, it's like the
three
worst.
Bushes, and then he trips over the entrance.
And it's right there.
And it's
you're
right
like, what?
There. And it's like the worst pratfall I've ever seen
yeah,
him
yeah,
tripping.
It's
like it's
well,
slow.
Dude, he's like old. They can't let him fall.
Yeah, you got Jackie Chan that fucking shit.
Oh, look, it's the door right there.
Uncover it.
I wish he just didn't even ever move. He's just like, oh, look, there's the treasure right there.
It's over there, guys.
Where's Cleopatra's tomb? Oh, look.
So,
I broke my hip,
so
but I think
they,
the door's right
they
there.
They open up this fucking temple, and then they make the kid go down first.
Dude, that's the... Right?
They make kid go first.
At this point...
They, like, he's pushing him down the
like,
stairs.
Like,
they're
like,
walking
out the light... He has the flashlight.
Like,
he's pushing
yeah.
a child with nothing.
This is ancient...
There's like an acid trap.
Yeah,
like an arrow shoots
you,
out.
You think your fucking grandchild is a human shield? Before you want, you're pushing it down.
It's like,
steps. It could be anything down there.
Some Rick Sanchez level shit.
Yeah, it's insane, man. God, tell him to wait up. You know what I mean? What are you doing? This is the most irresponsible grandfather ever.
He's awful.
It's like. It's like his grandson's like a litmus test for how dangerous something is. Yeah, boy, you heal like rubber. Go ahead. You know? So it's like a room that's filled with water.
With a little pedestal in the middle.
Pedestal in the middle, and then they put the key into the pedestal, and then two beams of light shoot out.
Yeah. More beams.
Get this, hieroglyphics. All right, fuck this movie straight in the face for this, all right?
It's so dumb.
These beams shoot on the wall, they wipe it down, they're like, what does it mean? And the grandfather goes, that means royalty, and that means, like, fucking anal sex. Who gives a shit? He then goes, I know exactly where this is. Doesn't tell anyone
why.
And when they figure out where... It's just the middle of the goddamn desert. Like, what did he figure out? He never explains this.
No.
Like, what those two symbols meant.
Also, side note, so the beams shoot out on, like, disgusting dirty walls.
Yeah.
And he tells his grandson
to wipe that
wade
shit up.
Through that water and wipe it. I'm like, there's two servants that you're
paying
to
clean
do
shit and excavate
it's like,
things.
No. After pushing his grandson into a potential death trap, he gets him to
here,
clean
get
off
in this
wall.
Like water. I can't see
wipe
the bottom
that
of
shit up, you little fucking shit.
They could have anything in that water. It's it's nuts. So
love
now
it.
The grandfather knows exactly where they're headed to without
yeah.
telling the audience.
But he won't.
Yeah,
but he does. He, and he doesn't tell anyone
or
else.
Head vampire
either.
Or anyone?
No one.
Anyone?
Mr. Rich. You have to say Mr.
Rich. Sorry. I'm sorry. So they get back up, and it turns out the nomads started... No, they have to camp there, right?
Well, the nomads were also camping, so there's another meet cute with the little boy. I think she gives him, like, a hand job in the scene or something.
No, and that's when the nomad dad, before that,
they set up camp for the night, and they have their little conversation there. Because I remember, like, I remember the kid roasting marshmallows. I specifically remember this because it bothered me.
No, you're
the
right.
Well, that's before they go to bed.
That's before
like,
they go to
during
bed.
During
I'm talking
daytime
about
still.
During the
okay,
day.
Daytime.
Because the dad warns the kid that they shouldn't trust Mr. Rich.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's like, head vampire's evil.
Yeah. I remember that. I couldn't remember if that was
and
before
and then his grandfather
or after.
Comes over.
The camping scene.
His grandfather comes over. He's like, Grandpa, he said we shouldn't trust.
And
he's like, oh, what is everyone doing? Yeah.
Blah, blah, blah. I'm so very not British. while that's going on, the monkey is stabbing. The monkey has this awesome tiny little dagger.
And he's stabbing these tires. And
he's trying to slow him
slowly,
down.
Yeah, to slowly.
So the buddies can
catch up. And then the cat rolls up on him. And said another example of when someone should have died. Instead of just fucking shanking the shit out of the cat. He just runs away with his knife in hand.
Yeah, what the fuck was he
doing? I would have just stab it in the eyeballs, man. Like,
this is a cat that you know has ulterior motives against even the bad guy at this point.
Yeah,
no. He's been listening to everyone talk.
Yeah.
He knows what's going on.
Why wouldn't you
stab
it?
This cat cannot be trusted even by the bad guy.
You have a knife.
Kill him.
Stab it.
Whatever. So,
so many people should have died in this movie.
They set up camp before they go toward where the grandfather knows is where the tomb is. And that's when they do the marshmallow roasting.
Yeah, and he takes one bite out of the marshmallow. And the grandfather's like, all right, time to go to bed.
Yep. Bedtime.
If something happens here, though, right?
Hit the racks is what he says.
Is this where Mr.
Rich... weird way to say go to bed.
I specifically remember
like,
that.
Is this where Mr. Rich tells the servants that he's going to...
fuck him over and kill
he's
him.
He's going to kill the grandfather?
Well,
and the kid,
they
too.
They start going to bed, and then the buddies go to bed... And that's
the buddies go to bed somewhere in the desert.
In the desert,
yeah,
so
in the middle of the desert
some
with the camel.
Bullshit! What the fuck do they talk about?
They talk about Cleopatra.
Cleopatra and friendship and
friendship and bunnies knows. And happiness and clouds.
And the scenes with just animals
is terrifyingly boring.
Yeah, like, oh my god, why does everyone speak so slowly?
They fall asleep somewhere in the desert. It's, whatever, but. This one, Mr. Rich is telling the two lackeys that we're going to, basically, he says we're going to
kill the kid
and the grandfather, and then the goal will be mine. I mean, ours. And then the kid hears him talking, because
he stumbles back.
Are like 4 feet. Dude, it's like 4 or 5 feet apart.
Yeah, you're right.
It's
there
like,
was
what
no...
are you doing? Don't even talk about your plan yet. It's not like you're in a house, you're in a fucking tent.
And the kid trips over something, the sound happens.
And like,
you know,
what was that? I'm like, there's a gang of nomads right over there.
Yeah.
There's people there, you're going to hear noises. Why? What was that? Is it someone listening to the walls of our tent?
We have giant holes in the window the kid was looking through. It's like, dude, that's right in your peripheral vision. Like, how did you not see that kid looking at you through that big-ass window in your tent?
It's amazing. So he goes and wakes his grandfather up, who is soundly
sleeping. I love this scene, man. That guy went to bed being like, man, I'm hot on the tails of like, clinching my lifelong dream with the help of this strange but helpful man. And my 10-year-old
strange but helpful man.
And my 10-year-old son or grandson. And then he gets woken up to, hey, that guy's evil. And he goes, wait, what's going on? And then the guy, like one of the hired people, like grabs the child like he's gonna kill him. And he goes, oh, am I evil? And he's just like so calm about it. Like, yeah. He's just like, oh, wait, hold on. Well, don't go crazy now. Let's calm down. It's like, wait.
Well.
What did you Mr. Rich
woken from a sound sleep?
Question. Now, I got lost on this little point. Was Mr. Rich in it for the power of the jewel, or is he just in it for
the treasure?
He wanted the money.
Did he said
the
that?
Cat
at some
wanted
point?
The treasure.
No, he wanted.
I don't feel like he ever said specifically he was in it for the gold.
Yes,
you know?
He does at points. He
okay,
says,
he
I'm going to be
yeah,
rich.
Yeah, he was always looking for that treasure.
Well,
the cat,
he was Mr. Rich.
The cat wanted the cat wanted the specific Cleopatra thing.
More without
the,
having some fucking bloodlust for gold.
Yeah, I mean, obviously.
Speaking of bloodlust for gold, I want to point this out because we didn't go over it. The opening like title credits of this film ripped off DuckTales font so hard. I just wanted to throw back to that because I was just reminded of it.
They thought that they were Indiana Jones, but no, it looks like
DuckTales. It was straight up DuckTales. Yeah, it had the airplane and everything, dude. Yeah. I mean,
yeah. It really does look. All good
right, stuff. Back to
okay, yeah. So he's just like, oh dear. You're evil. It's just like the whole realization that he's been evil this whole time is nothing.
It's so dumb.
It's like, yeah, you just endangered your grandson in so many ways at this point.
All right, so what does it go to immediately after that?
I can't remember.
Them driving in a truck.
Together.
With the grandfather
under no type of duress. They're just loose in the cockpit of this
truck. Yeah, he's not like held hostage.
No,
he's just
nothing.
Driving.
He's just driving.
Just chilling there.
Yeah, yeah.
Like everybody else is in the back of all the people who could kill him are in the back of the truck.
Yeah, Mr. Rich is
he's driving.
Mr. Rich, who later we'll learn, has a weapon on him. But well, we do not know right now, is not even using that weapon to like told against his.
Like, what do you think that conversation was like? You were driving the desert
wait,
for
so
hours.
You got, yeah, he's driving. You got me out here to kill me and my grandson? Like,
so you're just going to make me drive this whole way to kill me? I
yeah,
feel
fuck
like.
Fuck you!
Yeah.
I would totally have grabbed the wheel and
it's
just swerved
nuts.
Up.
Why was he. It's whatever.
Like the guy, the granddad trying to explain like death to the kid.
Isn't this also when we cut. Okay, so they're driving and then. Oh, it's been an hour.
Jesus
we gotta keep
Christ.
Going. We're close to the end.
I guess so.
Because we're missing one thing. It's that
it doesn't feel like it.
It does not. They return because the next day they also before the truck driving thing, they return the camel to the nomads.
No, because
right?
That's them leaving the. Oh, Jesus Christ.
There's a whole night there,
we
too.
Skipped the buddies getting to the oasis and meeting back up with Bobby and eating a bunch of dates.
And
we
the random people dancing.
Yeah,
and then they go
food.
Back in the desert.
Because they celebrate the buddies for bringing the camel back, yet the humans who are celebrating them have no
yes,
concept.
This makes no fucking sense.
Because they
sense.
Can't talk to humans. They can't say, he saved me.
Yeah, they.
Because
no.
He's a camel.
I don't think they knew. I think they were just partying.
They're just
I think partying they
were
just having
do you
a
think
nomad
that happened
party.
All the time? Knowing what you know about the end of the movie, do you think they were just partying all the time?
Yeah, they just yeah. Dance.
They also were super cool with them stealing their hot air balloon.
Yeah, actually, now I'm like.
Like, that whole scene made no
they
sense.
They had a hot air balloon that was specifically the size for dogs. It was not a human hot air balloon.
No.
That thing was small as
fuck. No human being could fit in.
Like a child, maybe. But,
then, on top of that, they had a camera attached to it. That went to a computer.
Oh man, this is so.
And we were like, "How does that even work? Like, what?"
Right, because it was like a fucking Wi-Fi system in the desert.
Yeah, they had like a whole like it was like a little tablet with like a fucking like had like joysticks on it. Everything.
Like, what?
Wait, hold on.
So right, and so the buddies are now headed towards where they're supposed to go.
Oh,
on a hot air balloon.
Yeah,
that makes more sense now.
What?
Would they?
Because the balloon was always supposed to go to where...
And it didn't need to have a person in it because it had a camera.
But
and
how do they know where the location
thing.
Was? Yeah. Only the grandfather...
I forgot about the joysticks.
Wait, hold on. Only the grandfather knows, though, where
the location was.
So how would they know where to send the balloon?
They didn't. They just
kind
of
following
their
car.
Them.
Okay.
They just got.
Right.
Yeah.
That's how the buddies were able to.
They stop the car and they get out and they.
And he's like, "There's nothing here. It's just sand.
It's just sand." And then the kid sees the buddies in the air balloon. He's like, "There's the buddy, the balloon, hot air balloon." He's like, and the grandfather sees it and he's like, "Oh, there's not a baboon in the desert. Just so none of the bad guys look up." To the most obvious fucking sight.
Just a balloon with five puppies
in
outfits in it.
There's nothing
with
in the
monkey. Like the monkey on the side with a knife.
Yeah. It's a blank canvas of sky and sand, and there's one thing that you would look at, your eyes would be drawn to, and they don't.
And so then they have to land, and Bobby's like,
grandfather's
I don't know.
Like, it seems like it's gonna be a sandstorm.
Yeah.
Remember?
No, before that though. Does it happen that fast? No, because at first he's like, "There's nothing here," and the guy's like, "Go, oh yeah, you're right. I guess so."
He's like, "There's gonna be a sandstorm," and he's like, "No, there's not." And then it actually
the buddies have landed by the time the sandstorm thing happens.
Yeah. Oh man, they land so fucking hard.
It's like it looked like fatal.
Yes, it hits the top of a dune and then
and they're like they tried to sell it as like a humorous fall, but it literally just looked. It was like worrying. It's like it wasn't
you
even
see
like
what would kill a bunch of puppies. Here's
like,
the scene.
It wasn't like a fun fall. It was like Jesus Christ.
Dude, it was kind of the same as Snow Buddies with the crate of ice cream they were in.
Yeah,
good. Slammed so hard it would kill anything.
And the ice cream was loose.
It's just in there. You know?
It would have crushed them. Like rolling down a hill.
So then they look over and they're like, "Oh shit!" And it's like there's the Brendan Fraser sandstorm coming at them.
There was a plane in front of it.
Like it's some reason they crossed it over. You know,
is the Mummy
fucking
Disney?
Face coming out of it?
It's Fox.
The Mummy's Universal.
Yeah, it's Universal.
It's Universal. Yeah, so they can't do that. But it would look like the same effect as the Brendan Fraser movie.
With
the
face.
Sandstorm.
Just the face coming out of
it. Face to be in it. It should have been like Mudblood or something. Mr. Rich's face.
So this is the third time someone should have just been left to die. They're like, sandstorm's coming.
They get in
the
old boy,
man and the boy get in
the
car
first
and don't lock the doors
and let the villain into the car.
They let
like
him in the car.
Slowly walks to the car and like, "Oh, let me in,
oh, please!"
Like, dude, motherfucker, leave him outside.
Click.
So yeah, another instance where they should have locked the door and just left the old man
this
to
dude
die
was
in
threatening
a sandstorm.
To murder a child.
Yeah,
fuck him. God. We gotta get to this temple.
The buddies, though, they're like, "Let's go into that hole."
Yeah,
and they run into this hole, which leads to the
temple, Cleocatra.
The inside of Cleocatra's temple. It's a shortcut. Somehow.
There's a big ass snake mouth. This snake, voiced by Ryan Stiles, shows up, and he goes, "This is when we
I'm currently rewatching the Drew Carey Show, so it's very fun to.
This is when it. So
Ryan
this is
Stiles.
When we realized that not only is Digger related to Air Bud, but then Budasi was related because he goes, "I am the guardian and the only, if I look into your eyes and I hypnotize you, I get to eat you.
But
if you hypnotize me, then you're actually a descendant of
Budasi
and you're allowed to be here."
What?
Like, hold the
fucking
fuck up.
Phone. Confirmation that Bud is.
It's
like
a death. Dude, there's something going on.
They didn't even need to do that in that scene. They could have been like, "If your heart is true."
Yeah.
Or, no.
If you're here,
you are
intentions.
Related to Budasi through lineage. Air Bud is. Oh my God.
It's amazing.
It's a
scene.
It's an institution, man.
They're like watchers or something. Like they're here, or like you know the Slayer. It's but it's
the
Bud.
Slayer.
It's something.
Bird feels where the Hellmouth is. Yeah,
It's insane, dude. It's awesome.
Throughout all times, there's been a god dog watching over us.
There's always been a Bud. There's always been a Bud. There are generations of them.
But Digger didn't have Bud in his name. I feel like I don't
know.
What's
going
on. If he's Air Bud's dad. All right.
Because Budasi, I mean, like, it always should have Bud.
Yeah.
Digger was a special case. It was that fucking old grandfather, like, man's dumb names, man.
Yeah.
This dog has been around before Jesus.
Also, the cat villain had a dumb name. You know what
I
mean?
Like, well, humans are naming them, so I guess maybe they don't.
So he can't be of God. Like, he can't be a gift from God, because now at this point, he's existed before Christ was born.
He might have existed since time began. There's always been a Bud, and there always will be a Bud.
That's why he said he's the Slayer. Maybe. There's like a caveman.
That's why the buddies,
maybe Budasi wasn't even the first one.
That's why the buddies can go on like 90 adventures in 6 months of their life without growing up, because they're five of them concentrated. You know, it's like Hancock. They got together, and they're all
Jesus
gods,
Christ.
And they're more powerful.
It's like nothing is like Hancock, dude. That movie's weird.
That is a weird fucking
weird movie. I know. I'm kidding.
It's
but,
like Hancock. I guess, yeah.
There's five buds in this concentrated.
So that's why
together.
They have to deal with all this shit constantly.
Because the world's trying to take them down. They're like, you know, evil looks for good to destroy it. Sure.
I love it.
So
fine.
Fucking
whatever.
Deep for a treasure, buddy.
Sure. It doesn't matter. Yeah.
Oh, man.
Awesome. No, it's true.
It's so true.
Like, now they know about us, you know? And, like, you gotta defend yourself.
And they're trying to find us. Okay, so, yeah, he looks at the snake. He passes the test,
yeah.
Which confirms definitively that Bud and the buddies are related to Budasi.
They're mystical, they're magical.
The dog responsible for dogs being the dominant pet species on Earth.
And banishing cats, which I don't see how that like works.
Bud never
out.
Had an anti-cat thing, but
No, they
although the only other cat in the movie was this was that cat that chased B-Dog all the time.
Yeah. No, I so feel like he said. No, I feel like they specifically anti-cat. Said the cat ban was only for like a certain like number of years.
Yeah,
I feel like 14.
It
I think
no.
I feel like it was like 14 or 15. I feel like they gave it like an actual number,
okay.
If I remember correctly.
Okay. I think you're right.
All
right,
fine.
Yeah, you know they left a bunch of plot holes open, but they sealed that.
They
one.
Get past that, the snake goes away. Yeah,
we can cover that up easy.
They get past that, the
with
snake
numbers.
Goes away, and then they have to. The snake tells them that they're gonna have to go through
obstacles, trials.
To get into the tomb.
Like
you know, a penitent man will pass, a penitent dog will pass.
I hate this.
Well,
this
is like Legends of the
Legends of the Hidden Temple, which it looks like.
Yeah, it did kind of look like it. So
they get to the first thing, and it's like, it's quicksand, quote. And then Mudblood
just rolls.
Mudblood rolls across it and doesn't sink because he does it like that.
Somehow he doesn't sink. But then
one with dirt, so it works with sand,
I get that, but then he pushes a button, and this like plate raises up. That's like 4 inches under the quicksand, so you can't actually sink in the quicksand.
Yeah,
right.
You would just hit the plate.
Yeah,
and then they all cross.
Unless it's like literally an endless like pit of quicksand that the plate
like
just...
that comes up at like a million miles an hour and then stops and then just goes.
Yeah, like that's literally the only way it could work.
It's like steam vented from the center of the earth at a million miles. It's quicksand stop.
So. Then they get to like a direct ripoff from Last Crusade.
Yep.
Which is they have to cross a bunch of squares to get to the other side, and some of them will fall in and some won't. And they know that because they look on the hieroglyphs on the side of the cave, remember?
No,
the girl saw the nomads playing a game. Yeah,
she was like, it's like the game I saw them playing a game, and I know what the ones are, and it's just a diagonal zigzag.
Yeah, there's no jumping involved.
Yeah, you just go in a zigzag.
But,
and they played like scary music.
B-Dog's dumbass.
B-Dog almost falls in. It's a snake pit underneath.
Yeah.
Which is significant now because we know a human being will
bury.
You thought it wasn't gonna
happen. I couldn't believe it. They murdered somebody in this movie. It's fucking crazy, dude.
Treasure buddies.
All the time.
It's one death in it.
It's nuts, dude.
A movie where a dog eats C4 and that's not where the death occurs.
Nope.
So
they get through that room. But then the sandstorm stops. It uncovered the tube from outside.
Right.
Sorry.
Which is once again the only reason they found it. He stumbled upon the last thing, and this.
How did he know to drive to the middle of nowhere in the desert?
Because remember, he just magically knew. Because of the
he wasn't
so
even
mad.
Like using
it's
a map
like,
when driving.
The movie didn't even fucking care. You know what I mean?
They definitely didn't give a shit about the ending. They're like, all right, we gotta wrap. All right,
we'll get to this.
What's
this
the nightmare
next
we've created up?
What's the next clue? I don't know. Just see. He'll just know it. He'll just know where it is.
It's somewhere there. It's fine. So yeah. What? So they get to, this whole thing with the fucking door could have been thrown in the trash.
Oh my god.
They get to the door, and the door can't open. They're like,
and he's like, oh, it'll take months to get out of here.
I brought explosives for that reason, and it's the explosives that the puppies came in. So he's like, you can't blow that up. That should be in a museum. That's a door from the
Egypt. I love that scene because the grandfather, the head vampire, and the lackeys are all walking away, like trailing the wire to just go blow up the door.
And the kids
run. The little boy is just like walking
still examining
up,
the door.
The fucking...
And then the grandfather sees him and he goes, no!
And
he runs up.
And the lackeys who are like feet away, don't even
look up at the door.
They just are like pushing the plunger down. You're like, what the fuck?
And he just takes out the wick from the dynamite goes, right before they do it. And it's like he almost pushes the kid aside. It was like, oh, wait, we figured out how to open the door. It was like, were you screaming no because you were blowing the door up or because the kid was right next to the dynamite?
Yeah, I wasn't sure. Yeah, it was like, wait, there's a slot. And he's like, no!
We figured it out. We have to ruin the door.
We must save the door. Boy, out of the way! This door is gorgeous.
I'm going to stick my dick in the slot.
So the last thing, right.
I wish.
So it turns out.
Wish something interesting
in a weird
like that
fucking,
happened.
I guess, sort of joke, the last thing that this circular disc is for is as a coin that you put in the front door of a temple and it opens the door.
It's like pay to admit. Yeah.
Like
basically.
Pay to admit one. And so it opens the door and then. I mean, they get in and they get to the same. They have to go through the same two trials, which are the quicksand.
Yeah, they have the one dude laid out.
No, well, that's the all thing. Right. Okay, this is important dynamic for the group here. Because it's like, he's like, lay down. And he literally is going to sacrifice a man's life to get through this quicksand obstacle. And I'm like.
And they make the boy go first again. Like, come on. Like,
so the guy
just sinks straight down. Send the boy first.
The guy is like the guy that's laying on his back. On the
They're like
sand.
Stepping on his knees,
his dick and shit. Yeah,
yeah,
right.
And he's awful. Like falling into the quicksand. It's like, and then they get to the other side, and Mr. Rich is like, "All right, now what's next?" And it's like, he's just gonna let people die. He threatened to kill. Kill him! Murder this dude!
And
what
then,
are you doing?
So the old archaeology man presses the button that brings
lifts
the
him back
lifts
up,
him
and
back
all
up.
Three of them pull him in.
Yeah, and then
at this point the cat is roaming.
Then
around.
You would leave. You'd be like, you know what? Fuck you, man. You just tried to kill me.
Yeah, and then they go to
the buddies.
With the buddy. The buddies
well,
are in
that
scare room.
Concurrently, the bunnies are in the center chamber.
They found the temple.
The scarab. Well, no, they're in
that the
scarab room.
Chamber, the scarab
yeah, they're
room.
On that little, like,
right,
disc
right.
Where the scarabs are coming out.
Mudbud eats one.
No,
no butter,
Butterball.
Butterbean.
Because
he found a new taste
in,
for
and,
bugs.
Right. He, like, kills all the dogs in this room, and then he eats a bunch of scarabs, and then Macho Man Randy Savage showed up.
I wish.
And so, yeah, then the scarabs are all, apparently the scarabs are mad.
They end up just pushing a button, and the floor flips, and they go through a little slide, which turns right into the temple.
Yeah.
Cleopatra's tomb. Cleopatra's tomb.
Cleopatra's
sorry,
tomb.
God.
Good Lord.
So then,
So then
B-Dog's like, oh, I get my bling back, dog.
Yeah.
Give me my bling.
But then now, meanwhile, while this is happening, we go back to the adults who are in the snake pit room. Oh. This is important.
Big scene here.
This is an important scene.
I think this might be the first time somebody...
Dies in any
screen,
of these movies.
On any of these movies, it's 12 movies.
So they also figure out there's a pattern. You have to jump and accept the bad guy just kind of like tells him to run for it.
The Taki or whatever.
Yeah, he was like, go for it. The dude just runs and hits one of them and just drops in the snake pit, and you don't see him for the rest
really
of the movie.
He's gone. No one knows, my God.
He just,
or there's a screen.
And
there's nothing.
He doesn't say help.
And then he tells the other dude to like the other dude doesn't
that
get
snake
upset.
Pit was only like 12 feet deep.
It wasn't deep. It was not that
deep. He just dies quietly at the bottom of the snake pit alone.
Like, are we supposed to envision it's like the quicksand, the snake so deep he just sank to the bottom. Like, he's just like, he's still falling through snakes to this day. Like, it's an infinite like snake pit. Of
it's like a Sarlacc pit of snakes, digesting him slowly. Okay, so that guy... Matt, you he's were just gone. Matt was his, sure that he would
I was
be
like,
okay.
Oh, we're going to see that guy again.
No,
like,
he died. He's fucking
done.
Dead.
Fucking dead.
And his brother,
I can barely
believe
that.
No one gave two shits. His brother didn't even mourn him. His brother just went, fuck it, I'm out of here, and like left.
No one cared.
Like,
amazing.
He, just like,
and then the grandfather goes, I can figure out the puzzle. And then we'll send the boy out.
Yeah.
Send out the boy. I love this fucking movie. I want to. I cut the dogs out of it. Two old men sending a little child in like death traps.
It's great.
Like, is it safe, boy? Is it safe?
I kind of like the Air Buddies storyline just for the fact that it's literally a story about a monkey just like ripping them off.
Yeah, you're right.
The whole time, the framing device of the movie is Bobby telling a story, and he's basically just saying how he basically profited off this whole thing.
Yeah, it's literally we'll get more on that later.
Yeah,
but
we're closing in.
We're almost
in
there.
the center chamber after B Dog gets his bling.
He starts turning into
a cat, which is literally some of the most horrifying imagery I've ever seen in a children's movie.
But also, every cat statue in that room came to life and started chasing them, which I don't understand. If they're like descendants of Badassi,
Badassi's a dog.
And he's a dog, and he's wearing the necklace. So if he's wearing,
this doesn't make sense. That's right, why it makes sense.
Yeah,
it
doesn't make any fucking sense.
Because
they're getting chased by these cats.
They're
Wait a minute, the humans aren't in there yet because
humans?
They lure them all back.
Right.
Wait, that's why this doesn't make any sense because the dogs.
Dogs go backwards through the temple
and kill
the cat
statues with all the traps.
And the humans are.
But the humans are loose in there somewhere. Like,
dude, it doesn't make any sense.
How they don't run.
As I said, we were watching.
I didn't understand what you meant.
How did they not run into each other during that whole scene?
Sense.
Because they kill all the evil cat statues. CGI cat statues.
And then
B-Dog starts turning into the Gamork from Neverending Story. He looks scary.
Yeah, it's terrifying.
God damn, does he look scary. He has, like, green cat eyes.
And, like,
and
his
whiskers.
Face. And his face is, like, kind of misshapen because
like,
it's turning into a
creepy.
Cat face.
He keeps
going, like, meow, but he doesn't, like, meow like a
Instead
cat.
Of saying
it's just
dog,
a...
he says meow.
Which is an improvement.
It is.
He sees his reflection and takes off the
they get back to the temple.
This is where he takes it off, and they're all like,
he
"Are you
right
it.
Back into a dog?"
He literally just shakes it.
He's like, "Oh, okay, good, we're good." And then the cat comes in and just steals it.
Mr. Rich's cat.
Like assholes.
Yeah,
and then she goes back to Cleocatra's tomb.
And then
like,
the humans end up back there around this
rules.
Point.
Oh my god!
This is the humans.
The
are
movie
in there.
Ends before it ends.
I love
so anticlimactic.
So the humans are in there, and head vampire's like, dude, somebody's already been here. Everything's gone. This is bullshit. And then the cat comes in wearing the thing, and he goes, Ubuntu, aha, my
Ubuntu.
Cat, this is fabulous, you have it. Then the cat starts speaking English to
everyone.
Because we were like, hold on, can they understand this? And they started reacting, going like, oh shit,
there's a cat talking right now.
I like that.
That is so good.
I like
it was
that
awesome.
They didn't add a line in, like the cat going, yes, I have the power of the necklace, so you can understand what I'm saying.
Everyone's
not that sentence in there.
It was just people looking at a cat going like, whoa, what the fuck? Well, it's being like, I'm going to make cats the dominant species of Earth. And they're just like, what?
At this point, they had no clue that was even remotely a thing happening.
Yeah, no one did.
And so this cat turns around.
No human did.
The cat turns around, looks into this fucking statue, and like says her wishes, and then just gets immediately turned to stone.
Yep.
Like in the most anticlimactic nothing moment.
It happens so fast.
It's just like, blah. It's like, what? And so she's one of the Blackstone cats from 5 minutes ago.
Yeah. It looked exactly like the other stone cats in the room.
And that's it. That's the end of that story.
Yep.
That's
goodbye.
That
the whole movie, basically.
So
then, yeah. So then the wall opens and there's all this treasure and head vampire's like, oh, I'm gonna be rich, and he's like, you can't take these relics.
And he's like, oh, I can. And then fucking pulls a sword out of his cane.
He's had a sword cane this whole time.
And then the granddad grabs like a scimitar made out of gold out of the fucking thing, whatever it was, like a big machete or something. fucking sword fight.
80-year-old man. It's a really bad, like, 80-year-old man sword fight.
I wish
the dogs weren't in the movie. It would be like an okay,
you know, in
70-minute movie with just old men doing dumb shit with kids.
Do you know in Bollywood movies how like they recreate exact scenes old movies? I just wish they took the like somehow incorporated the what movie was it? Like a fight scene where they used the boy as like a weapon the whole time. Like, you know what I mean?
Man.
I don't know. Like, do like a Pirates of the Caribbean style fight where they have to like use the boy as a distraction constantly, like throwing him, like literally throwing him at each other and shit.
And hitting the other guy with the boy. Yeah.
So good. I wish that's what happened.
So yeah, the kid knocks out the bad guy with like a giant golden plate or shield.
The cat also scratched him in the face.
Yeah, the cat
turned into
the statue.
Yeah. Well, it doesn't matter.
And once again, when they should have just like fucking beat him to death in the fucking
tomb. Dude, they should
have
beheaded him with the machete.
Dude,
if you could cut off his hands at least. Yeah.
If you could kill anyone silently without any proof, this is the place to do it.
You're in a fucking
pyramid.
There is a
fucking quicksand pit not far down the hall. Push him slowly into it. Done.
Yep.
You're
no
in a
one
fucking
will ever know.
Pyramid.
No one ever. He's got, put him in the snake pit.
Anything. Just like the giant talking snake could eat him.
Remember, like, there's so many ways to deal with it.
Yeah. Well, the snake, doesn't the snake come back?
He eats some of the
statues. He eats the stone statues because he's a fire
so
breathing.
So then after that's all, after the
stone eating snake,
the kid knocks out Mr. Rich. Then we cut back to Fernfield, right? We're back in the museum.
Yeah, back at the museum.
And then, no. They have the sword fight.
Oh, they had the sword fight, and then we got to see the nomads.
Then
nomads pop up.
He gets the necklace back. They're like, this guy, they leave him lay on the floor. They don't kill him. And then he's like, well, son, see, that's what happens when you're not pure of heart. And there was a booby trap built into it so that no cat could ever wear the necklace again. And you're like, how the fuck do you know that? What do you mean there's a booby trap?
Did you know that the whole time?
And then the guy gets back off the ground because he was pummeled by a child. And he just gets up and he grabs the necklace while they're just standing there gawking at it like assholes.
And he's like, I'm running off.
See ya, and just runs away. And they're like,
gets out.
Well, I'm also 80 years old, so I can only keep pace. And they make it outside.
And then it fucking turns out the nomads are like Egyptian government agents and
shit.
Yeah,
they're the Egyptian like secret service.
Yeah, they stop
something.
Him outside, and he's fucking he gets arrested.
He gets arrested. They're like, yes, thanks.
And by
for
arrested,
this
I mean
thing.
They tie him to a camel.
Well, they go back. They go back to the town, right? And like they're partying, and he's like tied to a
camel. He's tied to the fucking camel. Yeah. He's like, let me go. Take me to the British embassy.
He's like, you guys are gonna be famous. Thank you so much for finding.
No
this
one
thing.
Talks about the dude who died.
Nope.
No, the dude who died has not been brought up.
Silently, and no one cares.
No one cares. His own brother didn't even give a fuck.
No, completely forgotten. It's whatever.
But then the guy's like, "You're gonna be famous. Thank you so much. If there's anything I could do," and he's like, "Wow, there's one thing." And then he convinces them to let him keep
the
this thing
cat.
That has the ability to change who controls the earth. Like, it's basically you're like turning. You just get to pick something up and put it at the top of the food chain, basically.
Yeah.
Like, what the fuck? It's in Fernfield. It's in Washington. Sleepy Northwest America.
Into the town hall of Fernfield.
Like, what the fuck?
Maybe it's
because
it's the
about?
Home of Air Bud. They're like, we can trust it. We know Bud is there. And as long as he's there, nothing can hurt him.
So, yeah, like,
I guess.
You know what I mean? He's like a protector at this
but
point.
But, like, the Egyptian. Did he tell the Egyptian Secret Service? Like, that? It's like. They're like, we're arresting this man. He's trying to steal a relic, and we're just going to put it in a museum. Did he go, actually, a cat talked to us in there, and that thing has the ability to make cats all-powerful, and it's the reason dogs are our best friend, apparently. So, like,
Also, their
do you
father,
mind if I keep it
in a museum
in a glass case
protected by fucking laser beams?
By the way, these dogs that are following us,
amazing.
That, these dogs that are following us, one of them belonging to my son, is part of the lineage of the dogs responsible for the entire planet's pet.
They'd be like, just
hierarchy.
Just take it. Just, get know, the fuck out of our country.
Oh, by the way, they killed a demon last week.
All right.
With a fart.
Just stop. Yeah. Okay. So, actually,
fine.
Their father won the World Series.
Stop
talking.
Okay? We get it.
So
you can take it. Just take it.
They're in this fight. The secret agent. The secret agents in fucking Ferndale. Ferndale. I don't even know what the fuck Ferndale is.
Butterfield Bean Deal.
And he's like, will it be safe here? And the Egyptian dude's like, yeah, I got fucking laser beams on it.
No man can steal that.
No man can steal this. Cue Bobby the monkey. Pops out of the sarcophagus and is like, ha! And then we go back to their stupid story.
God, that was.
I wish. Why did we have to go back
to the framing device? At that point, I was.
This
I said,
actually,
end!
I actually.
Stop talking!
I actually appreciate the ending of this a lot more.
I guess.
Now that it puts into perspective that literally Bobby just fucked everyone over.
Yeah.
It's literally what the whole movie is about. So you go back to the story, and the person he's telling the story to is like, his nephew is like, you're just full of shit, dude. I don't want to be your like, sidekick.
He's like, you're a liar. None of that shit happened.
And
you didn't sword fight anybody.
And that's when Bobby whips out the fucking cat. Necklace, yeah, Bobby. Just,
like, I ain't bullshitting.
The whole movie is literally Bobby just robbing the protagonists.
Would it be awesome if we went on to watch?
If he knows the story, why the fuck isn't he putting it on and being God? What the hell's happening?
That's what I'm saying. If we watch the
he's
next
like, no,
two,
I just want to be a petty thief.
Yeah, pretty much. That's...
We should watch the next two. When we watch them, hopefully, like, monkeys become the dominant pet species on the planet. And they don't explain why. You just have to know Treasure Buddy.
You just have to have seen
that
Treasure
Bobby
Buddy.
That Bobby did it. It was Bobby.
What you need to do is write, like, if I wish there weren't Planet of the Apes reboots. You write a Planet of the Apes reboot that
Bobby.
Uses this as the, it's like
Treasure Buddies is the prequel.
Yes,
to-
that is episode Bodies. Zero is Treasure Buddies, Bodies. And then that explains how Planet of the Apes.
Oh
happened.
Shit! So yeah,
it's really
so,
good.
Yeah, so he makes it the dominant species of planet because. A fucking monkey.
Because
of
a necklace.
A bunch of dogs helped a camel and a monkey.
So I
what?
I low key love the ending because it's literally it makes it just a movie about a monkey robbing a bunch of his friends.
Yeah.
Like it's literally
yeah.
just like a shitty asshole.
Friends he just made. Too.
Yeah.
He put a lot of effort into doing it. Well, and that it freeze frames on him smiling with the thing like, hey! Yeah,
I fucked them all over! Yeah. I'm a piece of shit!
I can't be trusted!
Yeah, that relic that we needed to have in the museum because, like, the beginning, you remember that? They're like, we need this in the museum. We aren't getting many exhibits and people don't want
to
come in anymore.
Have to close the
fucking
museum.
Fucking Bobby just steals, like, the
oh
whole thing
God.
They needed.
Yeah.
That's
insane. The humans aren't gonna.
He's
know.
The real villain of the movie.
As far as no, dude, think about
how the fuck did he get back to Egypt?
He's a fucking
case of explosives. Yeah,
another
sure.
case of explosives.
Dude,
ice cream
is
something insane.
That okay? The Secret Service guy, no, but the granddad knows that thing is all powerful.
Yeah, the granddad
gone. You think he's gonna freak the fuck out?
Would he be like, assemble the buddies.
Yeah,
we must hunt it down.
No, at that point, you need Bud.
You need Air Bud
himself.
He's like, it's gone again. We need Air
You don't
Bud.
Need the Teen Titans.
Like,
you need Superman.
He rises out of the ground. He just stares at them. He speaks through them.
Dude, I would love
into
it.
Their
like,
minds.
Like,
just
button.
Goes
like,
Super
dude,
Saiyan.
They blow like this golden dog whistle. And then they're just like, there's like a superhero. Yeah,
I like the idea.
It just explodes.
I just like the idea of him showing up, staring at them, and they're all looking, and they're so scared. And they're just like so nervous. And he goes to speak, and he goes, I know. Just gone. I just says I know. He like read his mind.
I know. Don't worry, my children.
Gone. But yeah, that's
so
the end
ended
of Treasure,
Treasure Buddies.
Or as I like
Air Bud 12.
Planet of the
Air
Apes
Bud
Zero.
So it's a clean. We need Planet of the Apes, as told by Treasure Buddies, and Air Bud by Zack Snyder.
Yeah, yes. Air Bud 15 by Zack Snyder would be so
I would go to the theaters to see that shit.
Absolutely.
I would pay. I would easily pay $10 to watch that happen.
It'd be so gothic and insane. Everything would be so drenched in darkness.
It'd just be about like an eternal nothingness in the universe, and everybody has to defend the galaxy.
Remake it in his image. Like,
oh, I forgot about that's right. It was the Earth.
He's
Zero.
Like Manhattan. He can't take.
Yeah, everybody. He's all powerful. He's just like floating, and like he's not like the whole movie. He's not even on all fours. He just like floats the whole movie. Dude, he's just like a fucking.
That's what the movie is. It's people coming from the original Earth. They have to find Air Bud to solve some problem. But he's turned it almost. Like, he's turned it into this sports. Gladiatorial like war land where like they have to like get through these hellscapes of like dogs fighting in sport form, and he's like this war like Conan, like sitting on a throne
and then,
the top of this spire of like animals doing sports, and he's just like, I cannot for the worries of man. And you're like, oh my god,
this sounds like fucking Shang Tsung in Mortal Kombat.
Can you imagine like the music, the Zack Snyder like Hans Zimmer score that would go with that?
Awesome. All black and gray with red fucking shit all over him. So good. God.
Then after that, we would get, like, you know, Air Bud v. Wishbone.
Air Bud versus Wishbone.
Oh, man. Man.
He, like, whips out books and reads parts and turns into the hero.
No, he's like, there's another dog that's been throughout history, you know?
Jesus Christ.
There's only one other dog. Oh God! Please.
But Wishbone's journey through history is different than Air Bud's. Instead of a lineage, you know, it's more like literally. Wishbone. Yeah, yeah. Wishbone was like Quantum Leap with a dog.
I'm assuming Zack Snyder Zack Snyder would just rewrite the Wishbone mythos so that he would have existed through all of history. And Air Bud hates him because he's the one dog who has his powers.
Oh my god. Yeah, we just wrote Zack. I like how we said another podcast we're gonna write Zack Snyder's Air Bud,
Zack Snyder's
and then we
Air
just
Bud.
Did it. We were like, oh, we're fucking doing this now.
It'd
be awesome.
It would be great, man. I mean,
if you're gonna have him do stuff, make him do that. It's like $150 million.
Oh my
it's
god.
So expensive and no one wants.
Watching a dog brood.
Sounds like a lot
Jesus
of Zack Snyder
Christ.
Movies.
Can you imagine Air Bud killing people? The amount of people he would murder in that movie would be insane.
Awesome.
He would jump through. He would shoot, like, you know, balls out of his mouth at people. He'd be unstoppable.
Just fires footballs from his fingertips. Like a
wizard. And it hits me.
It's like fucking Riccio. It's like anytime it touches them, they just like grotesque, like blood explosion.
All right, that's
so
it.
Air Bud 12.
Air Bud 12.
We got two more. Fuck yes.
Two more to do, and we're done.
I don't loathe you guys.
I
want to
watch an
7 months
movie
of this.
So bad.
No, 7 months. We're gonna Exterminator 2 is coming. That's the movie we're watching. The first movie we watched. It's not Air Bud.
It's gonna be Exterminator 2. So,
yeah.
We've never seen Exterminator.
We've never seen Exterminator.
I could care less.
Classic,
dude. Anything that's not anything
that's not Air Bud at this point.
Jesse, do you have? This is coming out Wednesday. Do you have anything to plug?
Wednesday, yeah, I have a. Let's see, Saturday, I've got a stand-up show at Zizimo's at 8 p.m. I'll be doing stand-up. I think it's like a pride themed show. I'm not 100% sure, but that's at Zizimo.
Is that next Saturday?
Yeah. So, okay. Okay. It'll be out by like
okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So yeah, next Saturday. Come to Zizimo's 8 p.m. See some comedy. And I've got another one of my brutal panel shows on July 1st at Zizimo's, also at 8 p.m. If you've ever wanted to watch four comedians do trivia and yell at each other and me treat them really mean, you should come see it. It's pretty funny. I just recently started screwing them over and messing with their heads as the host, and I think I'm gonna start doing that more. So it's awesome. Really starting to like take form, this panel show. I've been doing it for like maybe like a little over a year now, and it's like, yeah, it's awesome. We've had good episodes. We also had bad episodes. We had a 420 episode where everyone was just so high that it was like an unfunctioning, like, and I think I skipped like two rounds accidentally. I was like, oh shit.
All right, we're in the final round. Whoa.
But no, and then check out my podcast. It only has like one episode right now, but Two Sad Bastards and a Microphone. We're about to start up again. I just got to get a new microphone. Me and fellow comic Jimmy Price, we have guests on. We interview them, and then we do a little like random topic segment that I used to do on my older podcast, and then we ask them questions about depression and get really sad at the end.
It goes with the theme of the title.
It's mostly asking them like what they like to listen to and shit when they're like, oh fuck my life, and you know, and we ask them like what their history of sadness and depression, right, if there is any, yada yada.
Well, thank you for adding to your sadness by watching Treasure Buddies.
You know what? It actually was an uplifting experience in its own way.
Yeah, when you deconstruct these, they're not as bad as they seem when you watch them. Worse, it depends. But yeah, this is kind of this changed the entire fucking franchise.
I'm glad I was on.
You witnessed
it. Yeah, this has exalted it.
I mean, the next
I'm
two
glad
movies.
I was here for this historic episode.
Whatever the next two movies hold, I'm gonna remember this. I'm gonna remember where I was
when you saw
that. Bud was truly and definitively responsible.
Where are you?
For humanity's pets. Oh, all right. Thanks, Jesse.
No problem.
You've just listened to Bonus Disc, available only on Thundergrunt. Questions, complaints, and movie suggestions can be posted to facebook.com/bonusdisc. Opinions and criticisms of the hosts of Bonus Disc are 100% valid, even though they took the time to watch the movies you were too ignorant to appreciate.